New Orleans has been rebuilding over the last 4 years. The Superdome led the way in that comeback. Another comeback story. Tulane's Joe Kemp from season-ending surgery to preseason hype. Tonight, he'll have to match points with Tulsa's speedy playmaker Damaris Johnson as college football's opening week party rolls on. Welcome to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods, as part of Kickoff Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Tonight, Conference USA gets underway. The Tulsa Golden Hurricanes try to roll the recent momentum into a new year. They face a Tulane team that feels they are on the improve. Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Tessitore. Welcome to College Football Primetime. If you watched the primetime games last night, you saw some offense that was sloppy and it was choppy. But tonight with Tulsa, we have the team that led the nation in scoring the last 2 years. Let me bring in my partner, Rod Gilmore. Rod, Tulsa, we've become well-conditioned to seeing them light up that scoreboard.
Yeah, you know, it's not unusual to see an offense struggle in the opening weekend. But when you have a dynamic all-around player, that shouldn't happen. And Tulsa has that in Damaris Johnson. He's not a big guy, only about 5'8", 170. But he is everything to this offense. He can catch it, he can run it, and he's big in the kick return game.
As for Tulane, hey, they're coming off a dismal two-win season, but they got excuses, Rod. Yeah. 17 players had season-ending injuries. Now, they're healthy, they're happy, and their two star players are back.
Well, you know, when we watched the tape of these teams, we saw two different Tulane teams. After the injuries, not really good. Before that, they could move the football with these two guys healthy. Jeremy Williams, outstanding receiver. He attacks the football in the air. And Andre Anderson in the backfield. He's a tough runner inside. They bring him out of the backfield. He can catch it big time. They helped them an awful lot.
Fans in New Orleans anxious for a good win. Tulane ready in the locker room, set to start off their year here at the Dome with single-minded focus. It has them saying, this is our moment. College football primetime in New Orleans, Tulsa and Tulane. The Golden Hurricane, they've been to a bowl in 5 of the last 6 years, and as for the Green Wave, well, just getting back to respectability would be a manageable goal. And moments ago, Coach Bob Toledo set the tone for what's expected to be a better season.
Once you go out, I want you to play from snap to whistle. I want you to play as hard as you've ever played. You play till the end of the game. You give it every effort you got. And the one thing I always ask, you never give up. You never quit. You play your fannies off till the gun goes off. Guys, I'm looking forward to watching you play.
And Tulsa's Todd Graham, no stranger to get his guys fired up. He's led his team to 2 straight conference title games. This is 3rd year coaching the Golden Hurricane. He has turned around recruiting fortunes, and obviously the on-the-field results are there as well.
Done a great job since coming over after the 1 year at Rice when he was there.
Led him to a bowl game. And there is Bob Toledo, 3rd year at Tulane. Told us that they're bigger, they're stronger, they're faster than they've been at any point during his tenure. Trying to get this program back. And this would be a great way to do it. Starting off Conference USA against the team that has impressed so many.
Never any question about whether Bob Toledo knows how to coach. Everybody remembers what he did at UCLA. Great career there.
Couple Pac-10 titles, 20-game win streak. Tulane won the toss. They will receive. Corey Jeffress, strong late kicker for Tulsa.
Now I'm anxious to see Tulane's offense. As we talked about a few minutes ago, when that team was healthy, beginning of the season, they gave Alabama everything Alabama wanted in an early ball game. East Carolina, they played them tough well into the fourth quarter.
DJ Banks and Peyton Jason to return. This is Jason from the 8. And he is wrapped up short of the 20. A 12-yard return. Arimanga with the special teams tackle. And Joe Kemp is back at quarterback for Tulane. Last year, he was starting to impress when he suffered a season-ending injury. Hit late after a whistle, broke his collarbone in three places. Steel plate, 12 screws inserted later, and he told us he feels the best he ever has heading into a season. He is a fearless gunslinger type Rod, but he'll need to keep things in control just a bit tonight. Andre Anderson, a gain of about three. Corey Doris with the tackle. The impact players for Tulane.
Oh, it starts in the backfield, as we talked about a couple minutes ago. Andre Anderson, big time running back for them, guy who almost led the NCAA had he stayed healthy all season long. Jeremy Williams on the outside, number 20, big time receiver. And then up front, the third year starter, Andrew Nierman, outstanding center.
Impact players brought to you by Dick's Sporting Goods.
Timeout.
And a timeout is called by the Green Wave, just a play into the game. So we will take a break with them. Tulane offense on the field to start things off here at the Dome. Stay with us. The trolley cars on St. Charles Ave in New Orleans, where the Tulane students can head to Gibson Hall, beautiful campus here in the deep south.
We enjoyed that yesterday over there on the campus.
Yeah, it is spectacular.
Beautiful. Wow.
Second and seven for the sophomore quarterback, Joe Kemp. Three receivers to the top. Casey Robottom to the near side. Anderson, once again, minimal yardage. Just back to the line of scrimmage. Mike Bryan with the tackle. Joe Tessitore and Rod Gilmore with you here in New Orleans. At the top of your screen, you see the starting offensive lineup for the Green Wave.
You know, Kemp is quite a quarterback. And he's a guy that the coaches tell you he's going to make the fans scream. He's going to make the coaches scream, but for different reasons.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. He'll make some exciting plays, and then he'll make the coaches wonder, what are we doing?
See what he comes up here with on third and eight. Kemp, pressure up the middle, got away from it. Looking to set up, but he is taken down. And it is a three and out for Tulane. Tanner Antle with the sack. He had 4.5 a year ago and off to a good start here in 09.
We'll talk about Tulsa, and everybody thinks offense, but they think this year that they're stepping it up defensively. A nice 3-0 to start for them.
So the dangerous Damaris Johnson to return the Ross Thibodeau punt. Johnson fields it at the 41. Little shake and bake. And able to get out to midfield. 9-yard return. Peyton Jason, backup running back, was able to corral him. In the past 2 years, Tulsa has been blessed to have top-level consistent producers at the quarterback position. Now the great unknown, Rod. G.J. Kinney named the starting quarterback yesterday.
Unknown, but folks in Texas know him. Great high school quarterback, went to Texas and transferred to Tulsa.
Kinney sprinting to his left and has it complete. And a decent gain to A.J. Whitmore of 6 yards. Let's take a look at the impact players for Tulsa, brought to you by Dick's Sporting Goods.
Damaris Johnson, you've already seen. This is a homecoming for him, having played his high school state championship right here in the Dome. And then on the outside, Slick Shelley, a Tennessee transfer, a 6'4" wide receiver, big play guy. And as Charles Clay is a big guy out of the backfield.
Kinney trying to run it himself. And gets a gain of about 1.5 yards. But the Tulsa defense pursuing with Adam Quintua coming from his defensive end position, and David Kirksey, the strong middle linebacker, applying pressure.
Hey, you get back to Kenny at quarterback. Look at him.
Williams, quick snap. And he's got the first down yardage. Jamad Williams, and Tulsa waste no time at all.
Nope. It is about pace for them. They will alter the pace. Hurry up. They will have four or five different paces. You see what they did last year, first in total offense, 47 points a game. But here they go again.
First down for Kinney and company. Johnson now, little fly sweep. He gets a block downfield. Johnson gets to the edge inside the 20 and finally wrapped up down at the 11-yard line. Chinonso Eshebelum able to run him down, but a 28-yard gain for Johnson.
Well, they have to find Johnson. They will move him around. This time he's in the backfield. Gets a great block on the inside there by Clint Anderson, 72, on number 6, Travis Burks. And Johnson is outside.
This time it's the big bruising running back, Charles Clay. And just a gain of 1 for Clay.
Well, you see starting offense at the top of the screen, but Tess, you remember that old game, Find Waldo?
Oh, yeah. That's
Johnson. You got to find him. He will be all over the offensive sets. You can't just fall asleep. You got to find out where he is.
5'8", just a 170, and very fleet-footed. They can get a first down at the 1-yard line. Kinney. Johnson, a little shake and bake down close to the 5, and you can see how much they try to utilize him every which way.
Well, we've seen him line up in the backfield, and that time they move him out into a slot position to the left side, but they bring him back around and use him like he's a running back. You know, he gets that running start, and then you're in big trouble. No linebacker on the edge is going to stay with him when he's got a head of steam like that.
So third down for the Hurricane. Kinney to the end zone off the shoulder pad of Johnson.
Kinney rolls his right. Let's see Johnson settle in. Does he try to catch it with his hands? A little bit behind him. Kinney usually much more accurate than that.
So Kevin Fitzpatrick to attempt the 22-yarder. And it is up, and it is true. They move fast, and they move often, does the Tulsa offense. They get on the board to start their year up 3. On the campus at Tulane, that's the tree that's covered in those famous Mardi Gras beads. Why? Because it's the first one the students see when they come back from the parades on St. Charles.
Do they throw those up there or hang them?
Any way they can, Ron.
Oh, they got a couple of them.
Tulsa with that quick strike offense. On the board, 3-0.
That pace.
Yeah.
The pace of that Tulsa offense, man.
They fly. Corey Jeffress to kick off. Banks and Jason back. And here is Jason. He fumbles it, then picks it back up. Looking for some running room and hard to find as Tulsa was swarming downfield. A return of 15. John Flanders made the tackle. Back on campus, brought to you by the movie Sorority Row. And the big 3 back healthy for Tulane.
Yeah, Kemp had that big hit. A cheap shot, actually, hurt his shoulder. Anderson had the broken shoulder as well. And Williams, a knee and a hand. First half of the season, all 3 of those big-time players were lost.
They got a big group in right now as Williams is in motion. And a penalty marker comes in.
False start. Offense number 45. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Big fullback to Plessis a little early. This November 8th of last year, Rod, this is how it happened.
Yeah, 22 guys are told the play is over and stopped. 21 get the message. Oh. One guy goes late. He's Phillip Hunt from Houston, a late hit, breaks the shoulder of Joe Kemp. And he only got a personal foul out of it.
Joe said, hey, if I was in the play, I don't mind. But that way troubles me. Here's Williams. And Williams able to get it out to the 25-yard line, a 15-yard run for the senior receiver.
Well, he's the guy that we've talked about. Big time receiver. You play him one on one, you better be prepared because he can go up in the air and snatch the ball. He attacks the football in the air.
Coach Toledo just flat out said, listen, Jeremy Williams is an NFL player. Second and three, and the senior running back Andre Anderson behind the big fullback Duplessis. Play action. Kemp going downfield for Williams. And it was thrown to the inside and goes incomplete as the coverage came from Kenny D. Sims.
Yeah, Kenny Sims did a nice job there. That ball was thrown to the inside. Kemp's got to get it to the outside toward the sideline. You can take a look at the Tulsa defense at the top of your screen there. It tells you who's starting out there for them. But I want to ask you, buddy, what did you think about that hit on Kemp? That cheap shot?
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, to me, it was a complete cheap shot.
Absolutely. Broke his left collarbone. Told you the titanium plate was put in, 12 screws.
Well, and it deprived him of a season, half a season of starting and getting experience. He had to spend the year rehabilitating himself.
Well, now they're spending time talking things over with him yet again. Second timeout taken by the Green Wave here in the first quarter. 3-zip Tulsa. Primetime football back here in New Orleans. And Rod, I think I figured out what's wrong with Tulane and their winning ways, their lack of winning.
What's
their
that?
Famous victory bell, it doesn't have a clapper inside it. Doesn't make any noise.
Really?
So if they win, nobody can hear it.
Oh, man. Well, you got to fix
gotta
that.
Got to get a clapper in there.
Yeah. But perhaps they like it quiet.
Coach Bob Toledo, he wants to hear this place loud. Just a 6-18 mark here at Tulane. Year number three for Toledo. Third and three for Kemp. Plenty of time for Joe Kemp. Gets it complete for a first down out to the 36-yard line to Casey Robottom.
Well, they do a nice job of moving the linebackers to create a throwing lane for Kemp.
And Robottom settled in there well and caught it.
Yeah.
But they say this is a guy, it doesn't even matter. He's got the best hands any of them have ever seen. Offensive coordinator says in 30 years the best hands he's ever seen. Play action, pressure now, and Kemp is swarmed. James Lockett coming in, a 12-yard loss. He had 8.5 sacks a year ago.
Well, there he comes from the left side of your screen. This is a defense that brings pressure from the outside. It's a 3-3-5 defense, three defensive linemen, five defensive backs, three linebackers. But two of those defensive backs are outside safeties, and they're almost always coming after the quarterback from the edge.
Cornelius Arnick also getting in there with Lockett. Lockett, second team All-Conference USA a year ago, and now a 2nd and 22. Kemp more time and unable to connect with Tyler Helm, his big tight end.
And if you're Bob Toledo, this is a situation where you want to be careful. You have a young quarterback who likes to take chances, will force the ball, and you're looking at third and forever. So I don't expect Bob Toledo to take a chance with this aggressive defense now and have something like a five-step drop back. I think it's screen pass, draw play, something to come back and play the next series and not have something bad happen right now.
Yeah, you don't need to serve something up to this Tulsa offense.
Yeah, he knows. He knows Kemp will take a shot if you let him.
Line to make, by the way, is all the way out to the 47. Kemp thought about taking a shot, but instead he is sacked again. Ontavious Scott. Third sack of the game for the Tulsa D.
Well, here's Scott down there on the bottom. He's going to just get good pressure coming inside, a little twist run, and two guys can't pick him up as he splits them perfectly.
Here's Johnson just short of midfield. Now goes back to the middle, still on his feet, down to the 42-yard line. So the Tulane offense not in gear yet. Tulsa back on the green when we come back. Ontavious Scott, big sack on third down. Tulsa's got the ball back, and that's always a good thing. We know they were one of the storylines past couple years nationwide, leading the country in offense. Some of the national storylines that we're keying in on here in 09. Well, of course, the Florida Gators seeking their third national title is first and foremost. Kinney keeps it himself and is wrapped up after a gain of two by David Kirksey. Kirksey had a great camp, according to everybody at Tulane. Holds every record in the weight room.
Yeah.
And he's a very active middle linebacker.
Very fat, flows to the ball.
Kinney now flanked by Clay. He's got time over the middle, and he's got it complete inside the 20 to Trey Johnson, who started his career red hot as a freshman when he went over 1,000 yards and had 13 touchdowns, and now he feels he's back to that form, a 23-yard pickup.
Well, look at Kinney read a book back there. He's got all day. No pressure at all. That's too much time. You got to get some pressure. Trey Johnson easily wide open.
Williams now just short of the 15-yard line. Adam Quintua able to make the stop.
Tulane only had 22 sacks last season. That was like 68th in the country. They've got to get some pressure. You can't let G.J. Kinney have all that time.
Look at this play clock here. 25 seconds and they're lined up ready to snap. Second down now for Kinney.
Yeah, they're checking with the sideline now. A little slower tempo.
They get lined up and then they look over at times. Kinney keeps it himself, turns the corner, and into the end zone. The former Prep All-American, who transferred in from Texas, scores his first touchdown for Tulsa.
Well, that's their base play. That's the read option. He's reading the defensive end, and that was Logan Kelly coming down, who was blocked tremendously by Trent Dupuy.
Fifteen-yard touchdown run by Kinney. Fitzpatrick adds the extra point. G.J. Kinney, who yesterday got the call, son, you're going to be the starter. And start he has. His team up 10. That's the big news in the past 24 hours of college football. Well, LeGarrette Blount. Boy, we were all, everybody on our crew, we stayed up late last night watching that game. And I think everybody across the country had the same reaction when that scene unfolded there on the blue turf in Boise. And now the news coming in that he is gone for the year. Corey Jeffress to kick off once again. Peyton Jason and DJ Banks back for Tulane. This is Banks from inside the five. And Banks wrapped up at the 18-yard line.
Let's go back to the touchdown here. Watch your center here come out and make a great block. Watch the end that is going to be read there by Kinney, the quarterback. Sees the fake, watches the end. Center comes out with a nice little block, a kind of a whiz there. But then a nice block down the field also by Johnson. That made it easy for Kinney to get in. Stock block. Now, if you're a defensive back, get rid of the guy. Can't do it. Johnson just stands in his way. That's great play by the wide receiver, Damaris Johnson. Of course, you know me. I say, you know, take the wide receiver and drive him back into the play.
Yes. Spoken like an old defensive back. So Kemp trying to get something going, and that ball intercepted. Brian to the 5-yard line. Mike Bryan, the senior linebacker, tip ball, intercepted, and returned 17 yards. And what a story Mike Bryan this year. His father, Rick Bryan, passed away this summer. Of course, Rick was an All-American at Oklahoma, played in the NFL. And Mike Bryan comes up big here for Tulsa. Clay powering ahead and in.
Oh my goodness.
230 pounds of Charles Clay pounding into the end zone.
Wow. He carried two guys into the end zone. You're talking about a big guy who was heavily recruited by Miami, chose to come to Tulsa instead, and he's quite a specimen.
Big defensive play by Mike Bryan, setting up Charles Clay. And Kevin Fitzpatrick is having himself a busy evening here. Back out again for an extra point.
Well, Clay is the beneficiary of a takeaway by the Tulsa defense, by Mike Bryan's pick. Clay finished that off, just carrying two guys into the end zone. Go back to the end zone. You see the pressure, and Kim's been under pressure all night long. Nice tip by Audric Ray, and Bryan is right there, picks it up. But that pressure up front was huge. Now go back to the touchdown run. Watch Clay, 230 pounds, 6'3". Watch him carry a couple guys in, just blasting through Kirksey. Wow.
So, a few things have changed with Tulsa, huh?
What did I say to you a little while ago? But we know about the Tulsa defense coming on. But what did I say about the Tulane offense during the break? What do we need? What do they need to do?
Power running game.
Too much pressure.
Yep.
And they've done nothing to stop the pressure. And they're a team that can line up in the I formation with their big 260-pound fullback, and they can pound you a little bit. We haven't seen any of that out of Tulane. They got to get back to that a little bit, settle down.
Banks. And DJ Banks gets to the 22. Tulsa defense led by Mike Bryan right back out there. And a mistake early here by Tulane. Tip ball and a quick six the other way.
You see what they did last season. Fourth straight game appearance in a bowl. Total offense leader. They have offense. Now they look like they've got a little defense.
Anderson makes a nice cut. And Andre Anderson with a 5-yard gain. And this is what you were looking for, just a series of go.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they got in there behind Casey Stelly and ran the ball. This defense, though, for Tulsa looks a little bit faster, a little bit stronger than they've been in the past. I'd like the idea of Tulane, though, getting back to basics, letting Anderson touch the football. Letting a big fullback lead him a little bit.
Only problem is getting back to basics once you're already down 17.
I'm with you.
And you'll see this a little bit, the Pelican offense from Tulane. DJ Banks will come in, play a little quarterback. Yeah. He even plays as the holder. He'll line up everywhere but offensive line.
Well, everybody's got a little wildcat or pelican or wild rebel, or whatever you call it. Everybody seems to be picking that up now, and Banks ran it.
Of all the wild fill-in name of animal or mascot, I'm not sure the pelican is really that feared.
It's not intimidating.
It's really not that intimidating now, is it? So Kemp now on first down. And good pursuit. 2 yards there. George Klingscale and James Lockett meeting up. Lockett and Klingscale, very active part of this Tulsa defense. They were inconsistent a year ago. Six opponents scored over 30 points. In fact, they gave up 70 to Houston.
Yeah.
But they feel as though the athleticism and the type of player on that side of the ball has really progressed.
32 has got to touch the ball more for Tulane.
Andre Anderson gets the call here. That'll bring up a third and five. Odrick Ray and Charles Davis in on the tackle for Tulsa.
That's only the fourth rush for Anderson for 10 yards against this Tulsa defense. It's 3-3-5 stack defense. It's a pressure-oriented defense. They believe in always bringing at least four guys, and you have to figure out where the fourth guy is coming from. And once you figure that out, they'll bring the fifth guy.
Third and five, and a timeout for Tulsa.
Timeout.
Todd Graham.
Tulsa. First charge.
Talk things over.
Timeout.
Saturday night on ABC, top 10 matchup. The Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week. Alabama, Va Tech. Oh, it's going to be a good one. Saturday, 8 Eastern on ABC. It's a big opportunity for Virginia Tech and the ACC against the Bama team. And you know what that roster looks like.
Oh, they need it. They need it. The ACC needs to step up and win some of these non-conference games.
You know, you and I talked a lot about that in this offseason. ACC, a lot of parity, but they need one team to step forward.
Well, they got to get Miami and Florida State back in the mix.
They'll be playing Monday night up in Tallahassee. So a timeout here on the field. It'll be third and five.
You know, Virginia Tech, Tyrod Taylor, quarterback, they're going to need some production out of him in the passing game. You know, we know he can do things with the football on the ground, but you know, two touchdown passes, I think, last season and seven picks. He's going to need to do more than that against the Alabama defense if Virginia Tech's going to get it done.
Darren Evans, the fine running back for Virginia Tech. He is out. Virginia Tech 0-20 away from home when they play against a top five ranked team.
It's going back a ways.
That game in Atlanta. Same spot Clemson was in a year ago. So third and five for Kemp. And the green wave in motion as the left side, both the tackle, Pete Hendrickson, and the running back.
58 offense, false start. 5 yards, second down.
Yeah, you can't have two guys going at the same time. And Bob Toledo's wondering about it. Now, this team, remember, they got hit with the flu.
22 players.
Yeah. And so that affected their fall camp. What did they have? Maybe 300-400 less snaps in practice than they normally get. So timing, coordination might be a little bit off because of that.
Sets them back to a third and 10. Kemp. Robottom stays on his feet and is able to pick up the first down. Casey Robottom, the sure-handed junior.
Well, you said he had the best hands on the team. You didn't say it was tough. Hey,
let's take a look at these hands.
Oh,
and prettiness.
How about that?
Nice.
How about that? How about that? That's a tough catch. And then he takes a shot. So he not only has good hands, he's a tough guy catching the ball over the middle.
And finally, something positive for Tulane, converting that third down. And now a little trick play. Banks to pass. Downfield and wide open. Jordan Stephanie. Boy, the coaches told us if he's on the field, watch out. The Tulsa defense needed to watch out. 39-yard pickup.
Now all you have to do is watch right here. He's going to come on out of the backfield and head down the sideline. There he is.
So they pick up the third down, get a little bit of confidence, a little bit of momentum, and then they hit big. Williams now trying to get to that corner. tiptoes inside the 10-yard line. Williams to the 9. DeAndre Brown pushing him out. 6-yard gainer.
Yeah, Williams not used to running like a running back. Watch him as he heads to the sideline. Now he's carrying the ball on the inside. Switch that ball to the right hand. Switch that ball and push off that defensive back. You got a chance. Pelican.
Banks with the quarterback in motion. And Banks tried to go right up the middle, but he was immediately met by Mike Bryan. Hey, a loss of one.
You know who else was in there? There was George Klingscale. That name rings the bell.
Klingscale.
Cousin Derek. I'm sorry, Dexter played with the Cowboys.
Klingscale himself, very familiar for the Tulsa fans. He's had 21 career starts, part of this defense that was able to put the offense in good shape just moments ago. But now Tulane with the trick play knocking on the door.
Back at it.
3rd and 7. Banks again as Kemp is split out to the near side. He's going to run it, looking for a block. Being chased to the outside, fumbles the ball, and it goes out of bounds. Mike Bryan with the forced fumble. A 3-yard loss.
Yeah, well, it looked like he had a hole there for a minute. And instead of cutting it back inside, he'll head to the outside. Looks like he had something right there, but he has forced back outside by Tanner Antle. And that changed the play there.
So Ross Thibodeau to attempt a 31-yarder. And such is the case when things aren't going your way. Bob Toledo. He knows what that feels like. It's been a tough 3 years here at Tulane.
Yeah, he's thinking that's a wasted drive. After making such a big play, a trick play, you don't want to waste those. You get a trick play in there, you get big yardage, you want to turn that into points.
Tulsa offense. And Williams able to get out to the 28. Jamon Williams, the junior from Midwest City, Oklahoma. He has the most rushing yards of any returning player. The problem is they lost Terrion Adams. He was a 1,500 yarder. They averaged 268 rushing yards a game a year ago, did Tulsa. Big misconception about the spread offense and the ability to run because Tulsa's committed to it. Now a little power here as Williams picks up the first down, a gain of 4.
Well, you say that, but Tulsa started out with a spread and they threw the ball, you know, for years. And they've evolved to a spread now that can really pound it.
First quarter counting down. Kenny looks over for final instructions from offensive coordinator Herb Hand. See if they get this snap off, and they do not. So G.J. Kinney in his first start, a 15-yard touchdown run, another touchdown run, up 17, zip is Tulsa.
This is our destiny, it's our night to shine, this is our moment, this is our time.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Part of Kickoff Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Joe Tessitore alongside Rob Gilmore here in the Superdome. Coach Todd Grand, Tulsa, up 17-0 on Bob Toledo's green wave. And good pressure coming off the edge from Logan Kelly. strained his knee just a few weeks ago in a softball game, Rod.
Come on.
And forced his way back into action, back into camp, inspired to get things going the right way for this defense.
He does a nice job of keeping the back, Williams, away from his legs so he can get there. Watch him get rid of the blocker. That's great. But softball, are you kidding me?
Yeah, he was playing against the administrators, actually, at the university.
You're making that up.
Second base, it'll get you every time turning that base. Second and 17 now. Kinney keeps it on the ground himself, able to spin for extra yardage. Remember, he had that 15-yard touchdown run earlier. A gain of 10 here.
Can you imagine how much grief Logan Kelly has been taking in the locker room for tearing up his knee playing softball?
Yes, but I mean, you're out there against like the chancellor and the
dude. You play football, right? Oh yeah, you got hurt playing softball.
G.J. Kinney. This is his time to shine. David Johnson, Paul Smith. The beat goes on for the Tulsa quarterbacks. Now a third and 6. Quick throw, and it was low and incomplete. He was trying to get it to Damaris Johnson.
You talk about Kinney. Just think about this. Colt McCoy ran a couple of pretty good quarterbacks out of the Texas program.
We're going to see one of them on Sunday, Jevin Snead and number 8 Ole Miss.
And this guy here. I mean, they both were at Texas and with Colt McCoy, and they looked around and said, you know something? I'm not going to play here.
For the first time today, Michael Such on to punt. DJ Banks back for the green wave. Takes a Tulsa bounce. So the defense has a little bit of an answer for 1 point. Joe Kemp has to get something going now. Been a good week at the U.S. Open, RD. Hey, how about Venus the other day playing doubles and she hits her sister right in the back?
I know.
Serena, square in the back.
And apparently it hurt her, too.
Well, how would you like to be hit by Venus Williams right in the back?
130-mile-an-hour serve or something?
Not quite Andy Roddick, but she brings it. Anderson chugging ahead out to the 24, 7-yard gain for Tulane.
He needs touches. He needs to have the football.
They need him to have the football. They need to slow this pace of this Tulsa offense, right?
Yep.
They play a little more conservative.
Keep their defense off the field a little bit. You know, go to your short passing game, mix it in with Anderson running the ball. You know, they do a good job of moving linebackers when they get three guys out to a side or so.
Anderson, a lot of traffic on that right side. He's a very good running back for Tulane when they use him the right way, but one of the best that's ever come through here. Matt Forte, the star of the Chicago Bears. And hey, we were online and he's tweeting already tonight. He's telling people that his Tulane team is playing Tulsa, whatever they are. Lots of laughs, just joking, he says. But he, of course, hopes that Tulane wins.
I didn't
injury
know.
On Tulsa's Audric Ray is down.
I didn't know you knew all those abbreviations.
There is Ray as they tend to him. Told you about Matt Forte. He actually played a very significant role in the development of Joe Kemp. A really good story with Matt Forte, Rod, because here's a guy leaves Tulsa, goes on to have great success in the NFL in the course of the past year, came back to finish up his degree in finance this past year. And when he did, he contributed back to the program because he was out there catching passes with Joe Kemp.
Yeah, he kept him out of trouble, too. He said, you know, you got to work hard, and Friday night, 2 a.m., let's go out and throw. I mean, he's keeping the guy at home. He's got him doing the right stuff, made him learn the playbook and all that kind of good stuff. I mean, that's giving back to the program a bit.
I know Kemp greatly appreciated that. Third and 3 now for Forte's old teammates. And that is batted again. And this time it falls harmlessly to the turf. Last time it was intercepted by Mike Bryan. James Lockett slapped it away. He's been very active so far.
You have to cut that guy so you can throw over him. And you see Anderson trying, but he didn't get into him quickly enough to get him down.
Here is Damaris Johnson. Penalty marker is down. He is wrapped up right away. Referee Claire Gausman.
Illegal participation, 12 players on the receiving team. 15-yard penalty, first down.
That's like a turnover. That gives Tulane the football. That's just a turnover. They went from having the ball, Tulsa, at around their own 40-yard line to giving it back to Tulane because they had too many guys on the field.
James Lockett comes in, makes a great play for Todd Graham's defense. And then too many men on the field. And Tulsa has to watch the Tulane offense march right back out there.
Early season, we see these things, these kind of mistakes. You also see breakdowns on the special teams, and you also see poor tackling because early season, some of these things aren't worked on in camp as much as they should be.
Here's Anderson jumping over a defender and getting it out to the 41-yard line. Tanner Antal was able to get to him. So the Conference USA opening game here on this kickoff week. Joe Tessitore and Rod Gilmore with you here in New Orleans. It's Tulsa's G.J. Kinney. In his first start for Todd Graham. Had a touchdown run. Charles Clay had another. And Tulsa up 17-0 on Bob Toledo's team. Here's Williams looking for the edge. Gets a block and is out to the 44, where it'll bring up a third down at about 5. James Lockett with another tackle. That strong safety, he comes up and plays the line very well.
Lockett does a great job on that edge. He maintains contain, fights off a block, and turns everything back inside. You can't play it any better than that. That's just a great play.
Line they get to is the 49. Kemp in the gun. Lockett pressuring again. Robottom, first down and a little bit more, crossing midfield. 9-yard pickup, Casey Robottom. Joe Kemp said to us, I don't think I've ever seen him drop a ball. He is as reliable as can be.
He's part of what they need right now. They need first downs. They need to keep the defense on the sideline, getting their breath, and they got to move the football. Mix in some of the short passes. Run the ball with 32, throw the ball with 32, Anderson, and take your shots down the field after you get that going.
The talented Jeremy Williams to the top side, Anderson the back, Kemp to pass again. And that was just misguided as he was pressured by Tulsa. James Lockett getting into the mix up front.
Well, Tulane is still trying to get the ball down the field, but they're still getting a lot of pressure from Tulsa. I mean, Tulsa's bringing 5 guys, and they know they can get there. They're not letting the young quarterback, Kemp, get comfortable back there.
And by not letting him get comfortable, Jeremy Williams, who's a phenomenal talent at wide receiver for Tulane, has been a complete non-factor.
Yeah, other than a reverse or two, he's been pretty
quiet. The vertical passing game, non-existent so far. Anderson now, good block. Taken down at the 41. First career start for Joe Kemp. It's 3 of 8. That interception on the tip ball that Mike Bryan hauled in.
A big third down. You know, I might even consider 2 downs here if they can get close. But this is big. They need to stay on the field.
The pitch to Anderson. trying to fight for first down yardage, and it looks like he will be just short.
Yeah, he's going to be about a half yard short. But I got to tell you, as tough as Anderson is and the way he's running the ball, I would stay on the field here and take a shot. I got a 265 pound fullback in Antoine Duplessis. I got a tough runner here. I got to make this.
Duplessis comes in, as does Casey Stelly, the other fullback, and Andre Anderson back in the eye. So a fourth and one. Anderson, first down.
Yeah. Now you see, that's as much for the defense as it is for the offense. That is to keep the defense on the sideline and to give them some hope that their offense can do something.
Much needed.
They had problems with that last season. There was a bit of a division between the offense and the defense on this team.
It was remarkable how everybody we talked to in preparing for this game brought that up.
Yeah.
From coaches to players, coordinators, the divide between offense and defense was so harmful on this Tulane team a year ago.
They had all those injuries and the offense couldn't score, and the defense said, look, we're out there doing our best and you guys can't help us.
Another first down run, and this time Anderson is tripped up right away by James Lockett. What a first half the senior from Texas is having for Tulsa.
He blew up that play. He just blew that play up.
2-10 a year ago, Rod.
They lost 17 players to season-ending injuries, but look at that bottom line. The defense allowed 40 points or more in six of the last eight games, and they were bickering with the offense. The locker room was divided. They've cleaned that up this year, but it's important for this team now to have some success on offense so that doesn't happen again this season.
Williams in motion. They pick up the blitz. Kemp downfield just airs it out, and that's what we talk about, where he's willing to take some chances here and there. Incomplete, intended for Ryan Grant.
Yeah, but I do like the fact that they're moving him now. They're trying to find ways to protect him. They move him out of the pocket that time to buy him a little bit of time. Now maybe this time you move him the other way. See the pressure. So he's running to his left, trying to throw. Now that's a little tough. Joe Montana can do that stuff, but not many other quarterbacks do that very well.
This is a different Joe.
Yeah.
This is Joe Kemp.
Yeah, you see, I grew up watching Joe Montana run to his left and throw it perfectly, run to his right.
Third and 12 now for the first time starter. Pressure again. And that ball was nearly intercepted.
Yeah, they just have no way to protect him right now. Dexter McCoy almost comes up with this one, and Kemp will force this. And there's nothing here. Watch him force it anyway. Two guys there. That's the part that makes the coaches scream.
So another field goal attempt from Ross Thibodeau. This from 55 yards, and it's just going to turn into a little pooch punt. And well played. Down to the 11-yard line, a 30-yard punt from Thibodeau. So once again, Tulane started to get something going, but couldn't deliver in the end. Not far away is Bourbon Street. We're here at the Superdome. Alongside Rod Gilmore, I'm Joe Tessitore. Tulsa up 17-zip on Tulane. Of course, the big talk about last 24 hours of college football was what happened up at Boise. LeGarrette Blount being suspended today for the year. Boise off to a real good start now with that win last night, and they're going to show up on Tulsa's schedule a little later on. And the inside carry by big Charles Clay, tackled by David Kirksey.
And the right call by the Oregon administration to suspend Blount for the remainder of the season. I think that's the right thing. I hope that there is a way, though, to work with him and give him a chance, perhaps maybe a redshirt year or something, to work his way back to the program if he has a redshirt year available.
Kenny out of the gun on second and nine. Pressure from Kelly again, but he steps up, and a flag is down as he completes it to Damaris Johnson. That's a 19-yard pitch and catch from Kenny to Johnson. Yeah, but this will be coming back.
Yeah, that flag is in the area of holding.
Holding. Offense, number 76. Up distance, second down.
76 is big Kurt Puckett, a senior and somebody that they're really relying on a lot this year as the offensive line lost some experience.
Were you in agreement with what Oregon did with Blunt?
I was. Well, I mean, you were sitting with me, and we were watching that game in the wee hours of the night last night, and you saw my reaction to what happened.
Yeah.
I've seen some similar situations in other sports that I've broadcast. A situation, in fact, in boxing, where after a fight, somebody was sucker punched, and he was arrested on the spot for assault.
Yeah. Well, the Boise State officials came right out and said that they weren't going to press criminal charges and get involved that way.
Kenny. From the end zone, lofts it out, and has slick shelling. And that is out to midfield for Slick. One of the great football names in the college game.
Yeah.
45 yards, Kenny to Shelley.
Yeah, and a couple of missed tackles out there, and the pressure didn't hit home, and now they're right back at the line of scrimmage.
Right back at it, a 45-yard gain, and they're ready to play. Clay, good hard running. Did he lose the ball? He reached back but maintained possession.
You know, Tess, part of this rushing to the line of scrimmage, it has an impact on the defense. It does take you away from doing what you want, but also it doesn't allow you necessarily to change plays. You can't change your defensive coverage. You have to stay in whatever you have called.
Rod, how about the fact the defensive line was just pressuring a quarterback in the end zone to play later? They're playing run defense at midfield.
Yep. After a 50-yard sprint.
Swing it out to Shelley. And Slick, not so slick that time as he comes up just short of the first down. Couldn't get away from Phillip Davis. Gain of 3.
Defensive guys are used to huddling up or at least looking to each other, getting their call and getting squared away and regrouping. They don't get a chance to do that with this pace. Now they're trying to figure out on the fly here, what's our coverage? What's our rush lanes? What are we doing here? And now they get a little break because Tulsa huddles up. This is probably one of the few times they've huddled the entire ballgame.
Third and 2. So for just a moment, they breathe and think about it. Johnson's in the backfield. And they wrap him up in the backfield. Chinoso Echebalam, a loss of 2.
And Echebalam was in great position to the right side of your screen, unblocked, one-on-one, open field tackle against Johnson. Does a great job.
Fourth down. Kenny. This is a planned play. He's being chased all over the place, swarmed and taken down. A big loss. The offensive line doesn't move. That is not a mistake. That's what Tulsa does. They plan for plays just like that. They tried to use it on fourth down. It didn't work out. Shaquille Smith coming in for Tulane with the sack.
Yes, but the defense was prepared for it. Look at the way they all attack. They've seen this on film. They knew that was coming. They handled it perfectly.
So Tulane's defense able to hold this time. More to come. Stay with us from the Dome. You know RD's drooling over this weekend.
Oh,
he's got a full slate of college football, some great games. This is his time of the year.
I think he's in Tallahassee Monday. That's going to be a good one.
Tulane's best starting field position of the game. Kemp tried to get it out to the big fullback Antoine Duplessis, but it goes incomplete. Saturday night on ESPN, it's Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic. The Heisman Trophy winner, Sam Bradford, Oklahoma, in the brand new Cowboys Stadium, hosting Max Hall and BYU. Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic, part of Dick's Sporting Goods Kickoff Week, Saturday night, 7 Eastern, on ESPN. And Jermaine Gresham is out.
Yeah.
The big target for OU.
I also think it's big for the Mountain West to play well in a game like this. They don't have to win, they got to play well.
Kemp Here's Williams, and Williams is taken down at the 37 by Kenny D. Sims, gain of 5.
All the talk out of the Mountain West Conference in the offseason about BCS Conference getting in there.
Let us in. Let us in.
Now they got a chance with BYU to go and represent at Oklahoma. I like Max Hall, the quarterback. That offensive line, though, is pretty inexperienced and could be vulnerable there with Oklahoma.
Now, Oklahoma up front defensively is something. Oklahoma's got some question marks across the front of their offensive line themselves.
Yeah, but they do have Sam Bradford back there.
They do. They have that guy. He's pretty good. Third and 5 now for Tulane. Kemp pressure again.
Oh.
And wide open. What a beautiful job just floating it out to Andre Anderson. 25 yards.
Yeah, Anderson's the guy who's got to touch it, but this is an example of guys knowing each other, working together over the summer. This ball's out to the flat. Now watch him wait on him. He sees what's happening there, and he leads him down the field away from the corner that is coming up there. DeAndre Brown was the guy coming up. He gets away from him, and look, more pressure from Ray, number 90, but Kemp is able to stand in there and deliver.
Robottom and Williams split, and now Robottom in motion. Two tight ends, Anderson the lone back. He gets the call. And he is wrapped up initially by Mike Bryan. 2-yard loss.
Mike Bryan shot in the gap behind the linemen, did a great job, and what a night he's having. He's got a pick, he forced a fumble, and 5 tackles.
And that tackle for a loss. Coming up on the 2.5 mark here in the first half. And it's a 2nd and 11. There is James Lockett. He is a player on this Tulsa defense. See if he can rise to the occasion here. Kemp out of the gun. Williams with the ball now. And Williams unable to make anything of it as Charles Davis came up from that free safety position and another loss of 1.
Yeah, but Lockett made the play. A number 6 was out there in Robottom, number 19, and he handled him. He strung that play out. I mean, Lockett is just doing everything. And he didn't make that tackle, but that tackle doesn't happen without what he did on that play. He won't get any credit for it. It won't go as a tackle. He's got 4 of those. He's got a tackle for loss. He's got 2 pressures, but he won't get credit except from us for that one.
So 3rd and 12. They can get a first down at the 1-yard line. Williams in motion. Kemp. And once again, nothing doing as Ryan Grant cannot find any space. James Lockett coming up and wrapping up.
But you know, they just need to get points.
Celebrating the 5th year of sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. $1.8 million in scholarship monies Allstate has already contributed. Ross Thibodeau. And something to cheer about, 27-yard field goal, and the locals can clap.
Well, that's
Tulane's awesome. On the board.
That's important for that defense. They set them up. That will help them.
So Bob Toledo sees his offense finally show something for its work.
We, like so many others, want to see, is Ole Miss legit? I mean, should they be the number 8 team in the country?
Was there any team in the offseason that got more hype as the it team than Ole Miss?
Oh, no, they're the hot team. No question about it. Folks are saying Florida and Ole Miss, and a lot of that is because Ole Miss beat Florida last season.
Here's Johnson. Damaris Johnson. He is a flyer. Spin move. And Johnson all the way to the 45. Big weekend in the SEC West if you want to just take a look and see what these teams are about.
Well, figure it out for yourself. You can see when you look at that West, forget about the East. Everybody says it's Florida. But who's going to win the West? Alabama, LSU, or Ole Miss? You can take your own view this weekend and see who you like best out of those three teams.
LSU. That's a long road game for the Tigers. They don't do road games much in the Northwest. Playing Washington, Locker back at quarterback. Coach Graham. G.J. Kenny getting his first start. And he is taken down as he tried to scoot forward, but Justin Adams came in and wrapped him up.
You notice that the Tulane defense has stepped it up since they got a little bit of a rest. Now you go back to that third down after the big play. You know, they had third and two. Tulsa huddled up. And what happened? You get a stop out of Tulane. They caught their breath. And then the fourth down, they come up with the play. They make that happen. And it's not just catching your breath. It's also giving the defensive staff a chance to call defenses that will work instead of being hurried up by the Tulsa offense.
Yeah, they could breathe for once.
Yeah.
And when you watch Tulsa play, the rate at which they will move along, it gets your attention quickly. And running up and down that field as a defense, it'll burn you out.
Speeds up everything, your whole thought process and the way you do things and trying to get everybody on the same page. And if you're not comfortable, it'll take you out of your rhythm. And we saw that most of this ball game.
Well, you've been preaching that Tulane needs to slow things down.
Yeah,
get that offense out there with long, sustained drives. And Bob Toledo has seen that a little more here in the second quarter. Got on the board with a field goal. And now Kenny with the pitch to Clay. And Clay grabs a seam and just absolutely steamrolls Alex Watcha. 15-yard run by 230-pound Charles Clay.
Now Watcha was not afraid to stick his nose in there at 185 pounds.
...20 seconds to go in the half. Kenny, that is incomplete. But now, as they've crossed midfield, they can think about taking a shot here.
Well, you know, this Tulane defense has something to build on for the second half if they can get a stop here. You know, the last 5-6 plays on defense, they've been good.
Kenny being pressured, able to escape, and able to get Clay. Clay inside the 20 as the clock continues to mark down, and now they stop it. 23 yards on the pickup to Clay.
Really good quarterbacks can make a play after the play breaks down. And Kenny should have been tracked. Pressure coming in, he steps away from it. Watch the delayed blitz. That's 21 Charles Harris. He gets away from him and makes the play. And that's what really good quarterbacks can do. Doesn't help hurt when you have a guy like Clay who can make a great catch with his hands like that.
Kenny 5 of 8 for 99 yards, getting his moment. Remember, it was only yesterday that they decided Kenny would be the starter. Of course, trying to replace the star quarterback, David Johnson, who's a grad assistant on the team now. Back in 07, it was Paul Smith. They had dynamic numbers in this offense, and Kenny is looking fairly composed here. Transferred from Texas. Here are the three quarterbacks, Rod, and they all have distinct characteristics and traits.
Yeah, you know, Kenny seems to be the complete guy who's accurate. Bauer seems to be almost the tight end, the guy who played a lot last year. And Beaver is the hot shot freshman, the athletic guy who can do a little bit of everything.
Kevin Fitzpatrick from 33 yards. And he puts it right through. That was a strong finish for Tulsa to answer. Kenny moves them down. Fitzpatrick nails his second of the game. 20-3 Tulsa. Now let's join Reese, Mark, and Lou back in the studio for the Olive Garden halftime report. Matthews Band, the featured band 2009 college football, and songs from the new album Big Whiskey and the Groove Rux King, which part of that album, Rod, was recorded right here in New Orleans, where Tulsa's on top of Tulane 20-3. We welcome you back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods, part of Kickoff Week, presented by Dick's Sporting Goods. Tulsa's going to get the ball to start this second half here. Head coach Todd Graham naming G.J. Kinney the starting quarterback just yesterday. Tulane had to take some time to settle in to the pace of this game. And now the bad news for the Green Wave is that Kinney and company will have the first crack at it here in the second half, with the dangerous Damaris Johnson back to return for Tulsa. Ross Thibodeau to kick. And here is Johnson from the six. Johnson able to cut a seam to the 29. So we're sitting around preparing for this game. We don't know who the starting quarterback was going to be from Tulsa, and all of a sudden we get the call that's going to be Kinney. Yeah. His first college start. You impressed?
Absolutely. Hey, he's played well. I mean, the one play that really said everything to me was when he was pressured and he made something happen. He got outside, made a completion down the field, kept the drive going. He's managed the game well. He's been accurate throwing the football. I don't know what more you could ask from him. He's even pulled it down and run the ball on occasion. So I think it's a great first start for him.
Had a 15-yard touchdown run. Also had that final drive set up the Kevin Fitzpatrick field goal before the half. But they're going to talk things over before they even get the second half started here. And that's the look of a coach who uses a timeout before the first play of the second half.
Yeah, not crazy about that. You know, you figure you have something raring to go and you're ready to get started. And Kinney really got it done in the first half. You figure you don't need a timeout here. Take a look at him in the first half. You know, drop back, find your way outside, break containment, and make a play down the field. That's a quarterback who's making something happen. Now, on the other side, defense, it was James Lockett all over the field in the first half, particularly in the backfield, just harassing Joe Kemp the entire first half.
Joe Kemp, the quarterback for Tulane, also making his first college start. Now, Lockett has made it a troubling one. Here are the first half stats. You know, Tulane, for a bit there, was moving the ball. They had a couple long drives, but not able to produce points on the board.
A lot of sacks, too, hurting that rushing average.
So here's Kinney after the timeout and out of the gun. Three receivers, the Johnsons to the near side, Slick Shelly up top. Kinney, there's those fleet feet we talked about. Look at him busting free. Kinney crosses the 40, still on his feet, all the way down to the 26-yard line. A 45-yard run for G.J. Kinney.
Yeah, he's feeling it right now. And right now, he's getting confident, feeling it like it. Like it was back in high school when he threw for over 11,000 yards and ran the read option. Breaks out here again, making the play when there's nothing there. Makes a couple of guys miss. Charles Harris, Travis Burks.
And now we'll reverse. Whitmore, who will play a little wildcat. No gain on the play. Adam Quintua, senior defensive end. He's a guy that the coaches say is buying into what they're doing now with the new defensive coordinator, Stan Stanner. Second and 10 for Tulsa. Slick Shelly tries to get by the first defender, just a gain of three as Eschebellum made the play.
Second time Eschebellum's made a nice open field tackle. But take a look at the Golden Hurricane offense last season. Play selection, 48 a game. Today, 22 on the ground. Throwing it a lot. Now, Kinney's very accurate back there. He's really put the ball on the money when he's had the opportunity to throw it.
Third and 7. Line to make is the 15. Johnson A flag comes in. Johnson spread out. Philip Davis came in on coverage, and a penalty marker flies in.
Yeah, Johnson got inside of him.
Pass interference, defense, number 13. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Yeah, watch Johnson make a move and get inside, and Davis will just tackle him. Now, he can't let him in there, but he does. Double move to get inside. What a great route. Set him up, broke off of his hip as soon as he started to turn. Watch right now. As he starts to turn, he gets inside of him, and now really a nice job. Great route. Poor tackle.
So a first and goal for the Golden Hurricane offense. A.J. Whitmore playing quarterback now. Up the middle to the five. A triple threat is Whitmore.
So if Tulane has the Wild Pelican when they use this offense, what is...
Tulsa just goes with the Wildcat. I mean, just keep it simple.
But they're not Wildcats.
No, they're Golden Hurricane.
Well, it's not a Wild Hurricane, then, huh?
The singular. Javadric Beaver bobbles the snap, but fortunately, Whitmore was coming around. Now, Beaver was the big recruit, the true freshman, who had committed to Michigan, decommitted, ended up at Tulsa, and that's the first look at it.
Well, and remember, Todd Graham and Rich Rodriguez are friends. They coached together for years. And Graham wound up taking Beaver away from Rich Rodriguez. And Beaver comes in here and, you know, struggles with that snap.
So now Kenny back in on third and goal. Javadric Beaver. Boy, he was lucky that Whitmore was coming around like that in timely fashion to pick up that ball. Just short. Whitmore tried to surge in, but he comes up short as Eschebellum and Kirksey came in on the stop.
You can't give that much room down around the goal line. I mean, that slant was so wide open. Watch Whitmore. He's got no one within the frame. He's open by 5 yards down around the goal line. You got to squeeze the receivers a little bit more. Take away that easy slant route.
So Kevin Fitzpatrick will come on out, hit from 22 and 33. This a chippy of 19.
Fourth down.
Helps with the angle. So Fitzpatrick now from 24. And Fitzpatrick puts it through. Hey, he may be a choice for a little college fantasy football with this offense. When we come back, we're revealing our college fantasy football picks of the weekend, Rod.
I'm
get
there.
Ready. I'm
all
taking
right,
you
all
on,
right, all right, I'm there.
Tulsa on top of Tulane. Joe Tessitore alongside Rod Gilmer. I've been waiting for this moment. You know, on our Friday night primetime show, we like to preview the Saturday action of college football. And one of the ways we're going to do that this year is to play a little college
fantasy football. You talked me into it.
This could be highly competitive stuff. We're going to pick a quarterback, a running back, a receiver.
Yep.
They have to be from different conferences, so we spread the wealth of college football.
Yep.
And we're going to keep track the whole year.
And we can only pick a guy once.
That's it. You use
season.
Bradford. You're not using him again.
Exactly. Can't pick
you
him every
You got to go
week.
Around all 120 teams here. So we will reveal our picks for college fantasy football in just a moment. Corey Jeffress. And back to receive is DJ Banks for Tulane. And Banks able to get it to the 26. All right, Rod, here we go. Quarterback, running back, receiver this weekend. Got to be different conferences. Where are you going?
Well, I got Jimmy Clausen. I like him against Nevada. Big game, a lot of stuff. Toby Gerhardt at Stanford against the Washington State defense. Big. And then a realist, Ben, against Missouri's defense, I think Juice Williams gets a lot of picks, a lot of balls thrown to him.
I know guys on the crew were saying, what is he doing with Joe Webb?
No,
trust me on this. Joe Webb, Conference USA quarterback from UAB against Rice tomorrow. He will run the ball like mad. He will pass the ball. A record-setting quarterback in Conference USA. I'm coming out of the gate with Joe Webb.
Throwing McKnight and Decker. I don't know about the Joe McKnight pick at USC.
Well, I think the freshman quarterback's going to need a running back to lean on, my man.
They got four of them.
Here's Jason, the young running back who Tulane is very high on. Pickup of just one.
So that's my question about the USC pick. So McKnight is a starter.
Right.
But they got some other guys.
Oh, yeah, I mean, they're loaded. I mean, they're absolutely loaded. So, you know, I see a game against San Jose State as Tyler Rice is slow to get up here for Tulane, where I think USC is going to be up. I think McKnight's going to be getting the ball. They're going to be relying on him. And I think with the young quarterback in Barkley, they're going to lean on the running game and utilizing him coming out of the backfield even more than normal.
I don't know about it. I see Gabo Johnson asking for the football, which is why I like my running back pick over yours. But other than that, I think we're pretty even. We'll see.
Oh, yes, we will. Of course, you can go to ESPN.com if you want to play a little fantasy college football. That's becoming the new thing now.
Yeah.
Fantasy college football.
Yeah,
they got the rankings out.
Not just the NFL.
Second and eight now. As Peyton Jason gets some time as the lone back. Kemp gets it out to Williams, and Williams busts free. Here goes Jeremy Williams. Tracked down inside the 10-yard line by John Destin, but finally the senior receiver breaks loose, 67 yards.
Well, finally, a little bit of time for Kim. Watch him step up and make this throw. Stands in there strong. And now a couple of missed tackles. Sims and Davis were missed tackles here. There's Sims. Davis misses one. But fortunately for Tulsa, John Destin doesn't give up on the play. But that is a big play for the Tulane offense.
Jeremy Williams. Timeout called by Tulsa. He missed the final seven games with injuries last year. He was off to a big season. He wants to get back to that form here in 2009. Tulane is knocking on the door. We'll see if they can break right through when we return. A year ago, Tulsa head coach Todd Graham had an easy go of it against Tulane, 56-7, on their way to winning Conference USA's West Division. Tonight, a healthier Tulane team with Joe Kemp back at quarterback, just connected with Jeremy Williams for 67 yards, and now this would be big if they could punch it in.
I like the formation.
Anderson, big block in front, but unable to cross the line. A gain of three. Tanner Antle got in the mix there for Tulsa defensively. Fine outside linebacker.
Line up and do it again. They came in with their big fullbacks. They went with Stelly at 260, and they also added Duplessis at 265 and put Anderson behind him. Yeah. Line them up, do it again. You got 2 yards out of, keep pounding here.
500 pounds of fullback.
Yep.
Leading the way for Andre Anderson. Two tight ends in. Anderson, the lone back again. Here he comes. Oh, and very good penetration by Mike Bryant. The senior, who of course playing with a heavy heart after his father Rick, the All-American at OU, passed away this summer. And Mike Bryant, 9 tackles tonight. Just 9 minutes to go in the third, and he has put together a big evening. Led the team a year ago. Third and goal. Option right, Anderson. Could not cut back against the grain. Tulsa able to get out and pursue and shut it down. DeAndre Brown, Tanner Antle, and Bob Toledo has a decision to make now, Rod.
Oh, no, he's going to stay in there and go for this because he's not thinking simply about this ball game. He's thinking about the season. Establish some toughness, establish some belief in your defense, saying, I'm trusting you guys. I can back them up here if we don't get this, and I know you'll go out and stop them and get us the ball back.
Fourth and goal. Tulsa stops him cold. Yep. DeAndre Brown.
I'll tell you what, Tulsa up front just stoned them. Their defensive line did a great job, and then DeAndre Brown was free to come up and make a play.
He is a hybrid safety type, plays physical all over the field, and he did there with the goal line D. Tulane could not get in. More to come from Nollins. Well, the AFCA and the NCAA partnering on a national sportsmanship initiative, Respect Weekend, as all teams in college football asked to meet at midfield and shake hands before the game. Of course, the coaches always do so. But who knew that this little gesture would end up being such a controversial buzz this weekend with what happened at Boise. Good stout defense on the inside for Tulane as Jamon Williams is wrapped up. And what's going to happen tomorrow between Oklahoma State and Georgia, Rod, is they've decided they will not take part in that Respect Weekend sportsmanship initiative.
Yeah, Mike Gundy said, look, we got 115 guys. They have 70. All it takes is one guy to do something wrong. And then you've got a big problem.
There was a big problem on the blue turf last night.
You know, I agree with Mike Gundy. I think he's right.
You know, I remember having quite a reaction when I heard you say that on College Football Live. Good pressure on Kenny, but he gets loose. But all the coaches we've talked to this week in the two games we're covering seem to agree with you that they are saying, hey, listen, this is a real hot button.
Yeah, very.
And this
emotional
sport can be, you know, things can erupt.
But, you know, it had nothing to do with what happened post-game at Boise State.
No.
And remember, despite all that happened, all the other players did the right thing.
That's correct.
There's only one guy who took a punch. I mean, that thing could have gotten really bad, but everybody else did the right thing.
We've seen brawls in the past, but everybody else was in control last night. Here's Clay. Clay trying to fight for first down yardage, and he can't find any. Phillip Davis, Chinoso Echebolam. Good D by Tulane.
Remember that first and goal, and they got nothing out of it for Tulane when Williams carried the ball four times and got 2 yards. And I said then that was Bob Toledo showing confidence in his defense for not only this game but the season to say, I trust you to keep them down here. And he did that with Phillip Davis getting in there and also with Echebolam.
So Michael Such to punt from his own end zone. Casey Robottom and his sure hands at midfield. Here's Robottom from the 44. Cuts back. Looking for a block. And they will start this drive with fine field position. Saturday night on ABC, Alabama, Virginia Tech, Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week. Who you like, Rod?
You know, I got to say Alabama. I like the fact they have so much coming back defensively. Virginia Tech without Darren Evans at running back, I got to go Alabama here. How do you feel about it?
I'll tell you, Ryan Williams, they've been talking to Brian Williams, that young running back who's been sitting and waiting. He has been something during spring and in fall camp. They may not be all that bad at running back. See what Beamer ball can get going early on. You talk about special teams. I'm going to put it out there. I'll go Vautech.
All right.
Tulane, good blocking for Anderson. Andre Anderson, big gainer down to the 20. 21-yard pickup for Anderson. The senior from Stone Mountain, Georgia, who was injured last year.
All right, here we go. You're going to see good blocking, and then he's going to get to the outside of this thing. A lead block, and the way you go. Nice job. He's got it perfectly set up. Gets inside of it with a great block by Jeremy Williams down the field to help him out on DeAndre Brown.
So first down from the 20 for Kemp.
The young quarterback now getting some help from that running game.
Robottom. Touchdown, Tulane. 20-yard strike. Kemp to Robottom.
And the ball does cross the goal line. Robottom with a great catch, great presence of mind to get the ball across the cone inside the field of play.
Thibodeau able to get it through. Got ourselves a ball game all of a sudden.
And remember, Tess, it is the football. Does the football cross the goal line? And Casey Robottom gets the ball across. You watch and make sure his feet are not out of bounds. No, he's in the air, and he has the ball going across the goal line and inside the cone. Good call by the official right there on the money seams.
What an effort.
Yeah, tremendous presence of mind.
Is that something?
That's pretty.
Stretching out. We told you that Joe Kemp says, I don't think I've ever seen him drop a ball. When I asked him yesterday who's the most underrated player on the team, he didn't even hesitate. He said number 19.
Yeah, but think about this sequence that we just saw for Tulane. Offense doesn't get it done. Trust your defense. They keep them down there. You get a short field, and then the offense makes a big play. That is great for Tulane as a team. Something they didn't have last season, the two sides working together.
Ross Thibodeau to kick to the dangerous Damaris Johnson. Johnson from the 11. Unable to catch that seam and then thud it down at the 24. Now let's check in with Kevin Connors.
All right, Joe, here's what's going on over on ESPN2. Rafael Nadal roared out of the gates on Nicholas Kiefer in second round play at the U.S. Open. He took the first set 6-love in just 24 minutes, but the German is up a break in the second set at 4-2. That's action going on over on ESPN2. For now, back to Joe and Rod in New Orleans.
Rafa back from his injury earlier this summer, and now Tulane back with their stars from last year trying to make a game of it against the high-powered Tulsa team. Kinney over the middle and overthrows Charles Clay.
I think Kinney was a little bit confused there. The defense showed him a look of two safeties back playing deep, and then at the last minute they switched up to one safety back, and he threw it almost exactly where that one safety was sitting in a three deep coverage.
Sip. Play in motion. Kenny pressured. Kelly can't wrap him up. And Kinney able to get it out to the 30-yard line, a pickup of 6. He is pretty good with shaking loose, isn't he? He's got a little bit of what the other two have. He's got a little bit of Shivajic Beaver, a little bit of Jacob Bauer mixed together here.
Well, he's got pocket presence. He feels the pressure. He feels where the opening is, and that's something that you really can't teach. Guys have to play enough to feel that, and obviously he threw the ball enough in high school to get a feel for that.
Third and 4 for the Golden Hurricane. Pressure again. Gets loose again. But can he get the yard to make? Yes, he does. And more. G.J. Kinney. His first college start. And a 16-yard gainer on the ground.
That's pocket presence, and that's saving your offense. Everything broke down around him, but he found a way to make a play.
Williams now will give him a breather by working it over midfield to the 49. Shaq Smith bringing down Jamaad Williams. And here's that pace that Tulsa can really create issues with against Tulane's defense.
Well, they see the defense, now they change the play, the call in from the sideline.
Looking for Johnson, and Johnson goes up and gets it. Little 5'8", Damaris Johnson with a first down, 21 yards for Tulsa.
You said it, 5'8", right? He's hooked up with Charles Harris, number 21, who's 6'3". Who should win this thing? Who should win this? Not the little guy, but the little guy does.
Inside handoff to Williams, doesn't pick up much at all, as Logan Kelly took him down after a gain of just over 2. So it'll be second down and 8. Kenny looking over now. Offensive coordinator Herb Hand, promoted just this past year. Kenny to Slick Shelley. And Slick has another first down for the Golden Hurricane offense. A gain of 10.
One thing to watch this weekend, if we've watched, an offense that is not in tune. If you have a couple guys who can make plays, it can make a sloppy offense look good. Kenny's done that. And Damaris Johnson's done it for his team.
Williams wrapped up on the inside by Adam Quintua. That is his 4th tackle of the game.
4 or 5 times in this game, Kenny's made a play to keep the offense going. Johnson's made 3 or 4 catches to keep things going. And opening games, you need that kind of stuff until your offense really starts flowing.
Well, based on what we saw last night, this is the best offense of the start of the college football season. This game right here, and there's not a heck of a lot of it, but I mean, to your point that the offenses are so far behind at this stage of the season, boy, was that ever true last night. Kenny now decides to run it up the middle. Not much room there as he's brought down at the 11-yard line by Brooks Cunningham.
Yeah, the lackluster offense happens every year, opening weekend, and you see tremendous improvement in week 2.
Of course, Todd Graham, head coach of Tulsa, used to be in the leading offense in the country. Last 2 years, they've revved it up to top the nation. Last year, they put up 56 on Tulsa. Different story now this year with Tulane back healthy. Kenny on 3rd and 5. Pressure coming. And able to complete it for a first down. How about that? Keeps him alive again, finding the big target, Slick Shelley.
It's the same thing we've talked about. That play was broken down. They brought pressure. They got him. He goes to his left and makes a throw back to the middle to pick up the first down.
Daryl Farley was pressuring him, but another key pickup for Kenny. Williams fighting for that goal line down just inside the 2. Justin Adams with a tackle for the Green Wave defense.
You know how frustrating that is defensively when you play your defense correctly and the quarterback slips out and still makes a play? It just makes you want to scream.
Kenny's a playmaker.
Yeah.
He is just a guy that'll get the job done. The transfer from Texas, who sat out last season. Hey, worked for Jevin Snead at Ole Miss. Better to play than watch Colt McCoy from the sideline. Fumble. Loose ball. Tulane's got it. Timely turnover for the Green Wave. Costly for Tulsa.
Wow. How about this Tulane defense never giving up? Charles Harris, the guy who was beaten on the catch by Damaris Johnson, delivering the blow, causing a fumble.
Watch Harris come in here. Loose ball as Clay.
Harris makes recovery, and that was actually Eshebelum who made the hit.
Genoso Eshebelum coming up making the hit Harris jumping on it, and that couldn't have come at a better time for Tulane. And here they go with Banks, that Pelican offense, as they term it. DJ Banks taken down by Corey Doris, and an injured player here for Tulsa.
Because he ain't running up a double slant. Let's get it. Good job. That's the way to fight.
Congratulations to Harris being given out on the sideline as he got after that loose ball in the end zone. Tulsa was moving, picking up and converting key third downs, bringing it right down, looking like they were going to knock it right in. Tyler Helm.
But it wasn't that Tulane wasn't playing good defense. It was that Kenny was making plays after the play broke down, after the defense was good. He slipped out of pass rush and he got away and he made a great throw and all that kind of stuff. Yet Tulane continued to play hard and caused the turnover to prevent the score.
So Helm walks off. Second and six now. Kemp under center. Kemp goes downfield and he's got Jeremy Williams. 13 yards. Kemp to Williams.
Williams getting single coverage on the outside and just running a comeback route where he goes about 18, 20 yards down and then works his way back a few yards towards the quarterback and a good throw to the outside.
Final seconds of the third. The officials talking things over for a moment here, but what a turnaround in a moment there when the fumble happened in the end zone. And Tulane's Charlie Harris jumped on it, and now a little life with the Green Wave offense.
You remember Bob Toledo's pregame speech? Tulane told him to fight no matter what, never give up. We've seen that. They're in a two possession game right now with the ball.
Remember, this is a team that just a year ago was 2-10. And in this game against Tulsa, they lost 56-7. But now back healthy and ready and primed with a new attitude. Anderson picked up the rush. And Kemp is able to get it to Burris. So Joe Kemp has been waiting for his moment. Will it be Tulane's moment? The fourth quarter coming up. Stay with us. More to come from Nollins.
Ron.
Look forward to that, Kevin. Right now we're looking forward to a fourth quarter with Joe Kemp making his first start at quarterback in college. Offensive coordinator Dan Dodd said he'll make plays that'll make fans stand up and scream, and some of them will make the coaches stand up and scream. And right now he could get the fans on their feet if they can deliver on this drive. Here's Anderson. Nothing doing there at all. Tulsa was ready for it. That's a loss of three. Mike Bryan once again getting up in the mix with a stop, his 10th tackle of the night.
Yeah, he hasn't been blocked tonight.
See Corey Davis flying in, by the way.
Yeah, Corey Doris is quick and now he's late.
Yeah, they really don't need an extra 260-pound Superfly Snuka on a group of people.
He's lucky he didn't get flagged for that.
Yeah, redshirt freshman for Tulsa.
Appreciate the enthusiasm, but
so it sets up a third and seven now for the sophomore from North Richland Hills, Texas, the gunslinger Joe Kemp. We'll see what he comes up with. Third and seven. Going to set him back another five.
Yeah, you got to get the play in faster. You got to be ready to go, particularly on third down. I mean, that's a big difference. Third and seven, third and 12. I mean, you got a lot of third and seven plays. You got a chance. Third and 12 is a little tougher.
Bob Toledo just shaking his head. There's the comparison of the numbers. Had the fine play to Robottom, the 20-yard touchdown in the third, but they need something big here to open up this fourth.
I like Rope Bottom now because I think he's in single coverage.
He's at the top of the screen. Wyndham makes the 47. Pressure. Unable to escape at all. DeAndre Brown. Six DBs were in, but that Bantam slot with DeAndre Brown coming in and pressuring Joe Kemp.
Yeah, here he is. He's going to get in here. They're not going to pick him up right away. And all the stunts inside. You see the stunt, the cross. He comes in free. Too late to be picked up on the outside by Nick Landry.
Johnson from his 34. Damaris Johnson. Watch out. Here he goes. The speedy Johnson. Damaris Johnson, the preseason pick as the special teams player of the year, set a school record a year ago, had 2,200 all-purpose yards, and he shows why he is so dangerous. 66-yard return for the score.
Yeah, his family is used to seeing him perform in this Superdome. He did it in high school, won a state championship here. Very comfortable here. And boy, did he make a couple guys miss and then made a miss with his speed.
Extra point from Fitzpatrick is up and good. Damaris Johnson, 5'8", 170, just a sophomore. 2 years ago, he was the MVP in the Louisiana title game in high school right here. Looking to be the MVP here tonight in college. Rafa's not bashful when it comes to the wardrobe, and nor is this guy when it comes to making spectacular, dazzling displays on the field. Damaris Johnson, the return man, the star wide receiver for the Tulsa Golden Hurricane, just went 66 yards on the punt return.
Yeah, he can save your offense, you know. If you got an opening game and maybe you're sputtering a little bit, he can make your offense look a lot better.
He just made Todd Graham, the head coach, feel a lot better. And now here's DJ Banks. Break it down for me, Rod. How'd he pull it off?
He did a lot of this by himself. Watch him right here. He's going to have a few guys lined up, and these three guys in position. No chance. Three missed tackles there. He's not done. Four, five, one more miss for good measure. Six, and he's off to the races. Not a whole lot of blocks to set him up. He just outran some tacklers.
Johnson, 213 all-purpose yards tonight. Last year, he was fifth nationally in all-purpose yards. He had 51 what they term big plays last year, plays over 20 yards. Tulane as a team had 51.
Ouch.
So now Kemp in a hole, and he gets it complete to his very reliable target, Casey Rowbottom, who had a sensational touchdown in this second half, stretching out to close the gap to 23-10. Now a 20-point game here in the fourth.
Yeah, you know, they really haven't protected Kemp very well, but they don't have any choice right now. You got to get back there and throw.
Opportunity for the young man to grow up here a little bit. Gonna be chucking the leather. Kemp, little pump fake, airs it out for Williams. Williams hauls it in. Jeremy Williams, who Bob Toledo says he's gonna be cashing an NFL paycheck. Another big gainer for Williams. That one goes for 52. Had a 67-yarder earlier.
A great pump fake. The pump fake sets this up. Watch him fake it here. That will draw in the corner. That allows Williams to get behind him. Safety's late coming over, and he drops it in there perfectly. The pump fake set it up perfectly, and Davis comes over a little bit late, the free safety. Big play, Tulane.
Rowbottom in motion. Anderson, the lone back, gets the call. Inside the 10-yard line, a pickup of two. Tanner Antle with the tackle.
You know, I think I take a shot right now in the end zone. Rowbottom's getting single coverage. Williams is getting single coverage. Williams, maybe you fade to the corner. Rowbottom, I think you can slam him in or have him run a corner route again. You got a chance. But can you protect Kemp? That's your issue down here.
Second and eight. They can get a first down at the one. Sprinting now to the left. Pressured and taken down immediately by Tanner Antle. He's had a good game.
Who hasn't? Who hasn't on that defense? But you gotta get rid of the football. They move you out of the pocket for protection. You gotta know if that thing's not there, you gotta throw the ball away and come back and play the next down. Can't lose yardage down here. If it's not there, throw it away. But he'll learn that, young quarterback.
Looking over his plays on the wrist there. Let's see what third and 13 offers now. Flanked with a little pass protection here. Williams to the near side, Rowbottom to the top. Lofts it up. And somehow Williams pulls that in. Boy, oh boy, I mean, that was just Joe Kemp saying, hey, let's buy a lottery ticket.
Well, we talked about the fact that Williams will attack the ball in the air, and he attacked that one. I mean, that looked like a pick waiting to happen.
Holding offense, number 71. Pass interference, defense, number 27. Play offset, penalties offset, repeat third down.
So they're going to repeat third down, but what an effort by Jeremy Williams just going up the ladder and coming down with this.
Yeah, this is tremendous. Look at this. He's grabbed and held down, but he still gets up and pulls it down. Now, that's a great play. Good call on the pass interference. Was the hole legit? That, right there on the left side, 71, right there. Big tackle. Just tackles his man. Takes Antler down. Tanner Antler.
Tanner is the son of Rick, who was an all-conference defensive lineman at Oklahoma State. Jeremy Williams, a very attractive target. See if he goes back to him here. Whistle's going to stop play as a timeout.
Timeout. Tulsa. Last
taken by Tulsa.
Timeout.
Well, they got a chance here. Does Tulane. College primetime in New Orleans, where a better sound at least is coming from Tulane, home team, as they've shown a little bit of life against what's been a Conference USA offensive powerhouse, Tulsa. Coach Bob Toledo has his better players back healthy, including among them this man, Joe Kemp. Third down now. Old screen for Williams. And Tulsa was all over it, so it'll be fourth down from the 10 run.
Yeah, well, I always thought going in, this is two down territory and that you need to go for it on fourth down. It looks like they're going to go for the three.
Well, there's no difference between being down 17 and being down.
No, it's a three possession game
20.
Right now.
Last time I checked, 8-8, 16.
It's still a three possession game. You
right.
Get the field goal.
So that's a 28 yard attempt for Ross Thibodeau. But based on the year they had last year and the score against Tulsa, any points on the board, a good thing for the Green Wave. And they make it a 17-point game. Sunday on ESPN, it's the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Atlanta, presented by Pennzoil. Coverage begins with NASCAR Countdown, presented by Degree V12 at 7 Eastern. They're going to be revving it up. NASCAR Sprint Cup in Atlanta. We're going to be revving it up in Memphis with the high-powered offense of Ole Miss, number 18 in the country. We'll have that broadcast at 3:30 against Memphis. Everybody talks about Jevin Snead, but
yep,
there is some other serious talent on that Ole Miss team.
Oh, I can't wait to see Greg Hardy, defensive end. Everybody's talking about him and that defensive line for Ole Miss. really something to watch. So are they good enough? We'll see.
Speaking of transfers from Texas, just like Jevon Snead, how about this transfer from Texas to Tulsa?
That real deal, no doubt about it. He's made play after play outside of the pocket. The play breaks down, he finds a way to make something happen, whether it's with his feet or with his arm. He has saved so many drives for Tulsa tonight.
G.J. Kenny, his first start, and he's had moments where you say, okay, this is a kid that just gets it done. He's a playmaker. He wins.
He's done a nice job. He's, I think, solidified his hold on the spot as a starting quarterback. Beaver, the freshman phenom, will play a little bit from time to time.
And now a short kick to Tulsa. And that's because they want no part of Demaris Johnson returning it. So LaQuinton Black, the cornerback, able to control it there.
A.J. Wright's limping a little bit.
Yeah, Whitmore slow to get off there. And there is Demaris Johnson, who had a 66-yard punt return for a touchdown here in the fourth quarter. He is one of the best return men in all of college football. Here's Williams. Jamad Williams with a gain of two.
All right, so going into this game, if I had told you Tulane's defense would have given up only 23 points, you would have went, no way, not with the Tulsa offense.
I agree with that.
Yeah, but think about last year. They gave up 489 yards on the ground.
56 points they gave up last year. They're a better football team regardless of the outcome tonight. And of course, Tulsa maintains their status. Kenny, here's Johnson again. Close to midfield. 15 more yards of offense and total yardage for Demaris Johnson.
The timing on this worked so great. A slant route off of play action.
They line up quick, then look over, get the play call. The Tulsa way. Williams crosses midfield. Gain of two. Eshebelem taking him down.
Eshebelem has been involved in an awful lot of plays tonight defensively.
11 tackles for Eshebelem.
Yeah, a big hit forcing a fumble on the goal line.
Williams and Clay both in the backfield with Kenny. Kenny to pass. Here's the big back, Clay. Not able to maintain his balance. It'll bring up a third down and about 3.5. Philip Davis chopping him down. Charles Clay's a big running back. He committed first to Miami, came to Tulsa. He looks the part. This is a guy to go 6'3", 230.
Oh, yeah. He's a real big back, and he can catch the ball. Really good hands.
Charlie O now in at running back for Tulsa. Option, and here is Opishitan. And he powers ahead inside the 40, down to the 36. Another first down for the Golden Hurricane.
They did a nice job of really kind of caving in that right side, the left side of the Tulane defense. Plenty of running room over there.
And that continues to count down. Fresh set of downs for G.J. Kenny. Kenny to pass, and scooping it up off the ground was A.J. Whitmore. Saturday night on ESPN, it's Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic. You got Bradford and the Sooners, Max Hall in BYU, the Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic as part of Dick's Sporting Goods Kickoff Week, playing that game at the brand new Cowboy Stadium Saturday night, 7 Eastern on ESPN. Oklahoma's other high-powered offense on the field right now, Tulsa. Ball comes loose after Kinney was ruled down. And, of course, Oklahoma State with their big three. They have a big one tomorrow against Georgia.
Yeah.
State's not doing too shabby,
no,
is it?
No, good football.
They like their offense in Oklahoma.
A good high school football in the state of Oklahoma. Here you see Kinney give the ball up at the end here. You know, this is one of the criticisms of the spread offense, that they don't run the ball enough to finish games. You have to be able to run the football to finish a game, milk the clock, demoralize the defense.
Third down, Kinney to pass. Pressure comes right up the middle. Flag comes down, and that is incomplete. It was intended for Whitmer. The pressure came from Alex Wacha, the free safety, surging in through the line to get after Kinney.
Yeah, yeah, but you know, going back to that deal, you got to be able, you got a three possession lead.
Holding, White, number 78. 10-yard penalty. Penalties declined. Fourth down.
You have a three possession lead. You need to be able to run the clock by running the football and finish off the game. When you throw, you leave time on the clock, you leave the game open, you leave time for Tulane to make a little bit of a run.
See what Kenny's doing here on the field on fourth and 10.
He should be pooch punching it here.
See if he takes a step back or two. And here it comes. And it settles in there at the 12. Conference USA starting the 09 season in New Orleans. More to come. ESPN.com. Search Football Friday for more fresh off the presses. Four wides for Joe Kemp and Tulane. And he gets a complete for first down yardage to Kevin Burris.
I think as we watched that Boise State-Oregon game, we were struck by that fourth down decision by Kelly to kick to go for it instead of kicking a field goal, which would have cut that Boise State lead to a one possession lead in the early part of the fourth quarter, 12 minutes to go. Those are the types of decisions that offensive coordinators don't make, but head coaches make.
Kemp. That was batted down at the line of scrimmage. That's happened a few times tonight. Let's take a look at what's coming up after the game. Sports Center. A little punch and punishment. You know what that's about. Tiger with some putting troubles, but the big story that is taking the spotlight of college football so far in this opening weekend is LeGarrette Blount. I think the video is just something you watch.
Well, and absolutely. And you know, we walk on the field before this ball game and the coaches are talking about
Everybody's
talking about it.
Brings about that visceral reaction. See a man sucker punched. That was overthrown as he was looking at Casey Robottom. I know he's got good hands, but he can't jump like Shaq.
Does Shaq jump?
Well, he's tall enough. I guess he doesn't need to jump,
right?
Okay,
all right. I just thought you were going to go elsewhere, not Shaq.
There is a Shaq on their team, though. We got a defensive back by the name of Shaquille Smith on Tulane.
And named after him. I mean, his name was Shaquille O'Neal.
Little Shaq.
Yeah.
Third and 10 now for Kemp. Taking his time and finally getting it out to Anderson, the running back, who has given him a little help, and he gets the first down.
Almost held that ball too long. I think that's one of the things he'll work on. You got to make your decisions a little bit faster. He's held on to that football at times and has paid the price. He's been hit quite a bit tonight, and some of that's poor protection, but some of that's holding the football too long.
Let's So the sophomore Joe Kemp was knocked out, lost for the season last year with an injury, getting an opportunity to grow up here fast. And this is complete, just short of midfield. Robottom again, 15-yard gain. Casey Robottom is something, isn't he?
I think they found another good piece to the offense. A guy who's dependable, will catch the ball, is tough, will take the hit. That's another guy that can bail them out of some tough situations.
We have seen some good receivers on both sides tonight. I mean, Demaris Johnson is an emerging star. Slick Shelley and both Williams and Robottom for Tulane. And now here's DJ Banks. He's going to pass it. Looking for Williams. Oh, and it is picked off. Heck of a play by John Destin. And a decent return to boot. So they put in DJ Banks, who plays quarterback in what they term their Pelican offense. It's their version of the Wildcat. He lofts it up for the Speedy Williams. But Destin was all over it.
Well, Destin did a nice job, never popped the fake, was playing back there, and ball a little bit underthrown, but Destin does a nice job, goes up to get it. Nice catch, bringing that ball back. Nice effort there.
Tulsa defense wasn't sold. They didn't really buy into what was happening with DJ Banks in there.
Yeah.
Kenny and company back to business of trying to run out this clock. And Williams is stacked up after a gain of three.
You know, Tess, you mentioned the skill players, receivers. I thought it was interesting that Bob Toledo told us the other day, he said the skill players in Conference USA, quarterbacks, receivers, running backs, cornerbacks, are as good as any in the country. It's the linemen where you find the difference, the defensive linemen and the offensive linemen.
Well, this is a league that is full of offensive talent. I mean, what's going on at Houston? We talked about Joe Webb at UAB.
Yep.
Tulsa led the nation in offense the last 2 years. And here's Charles Clay. And when he starts going downhill, watch out. It's going to be an avalanche. And he runs for a first down to the 41.
Yeah, there are not many teams that have a guy 6'3", 230, who can run like that. It can come out of the backfield and catch the football. That's the kind of skill you find in this conference and other conferences.
Travis Burks being tended to. He's the linebacker for the Green Wave defense. His first year as a full-time starter. Remind you that Saturday night on ABC, you have Alabama and Virginia Tech in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines, part of Dick's Sporting Goods Kickoff Week. Sets up just like last year. Clemson was hyped, highly ranked, the ACC team that everybody was picking to win and maybe be a dark horse for getting into the BCS and contending for a title.
Yeah.
Same being said of Virginia Tech, but just like Clemson, you got to get over this huge obstacle of the tie.
Although Alabama is a little bit more highly rated this year than they were considered last year going into the season.
That is right. They didn't get credit early on last year. They earned it throughout.
I tell you, tomorrow sets up nicely. A little game day to start the day. And we'll do a little work at Ole Miss, and then we'll catch a couple of those games tomorrow night. See the SEC West with LSU and Alabama.
Of course, BYU, Oklahoma tomorrow. Fresh set of downs for Charles Clay.
So how committed are we to making sure we get game day? We're going to get that 6 a.m. flight, get to Memphis, get game day, get some work done, and then catch SEC football, catch Alabama. And catch LSU. Makes sense to you?
It makes a lot of sense to me. Yeah. Get on the flight, get up there to Memphis, spend some time with the Tigers and Ole Miss, and then settle in for a day of watching all the festivities. Tomorrow's one of those great couch days, isn't it?
Yeah, and game day's got all the stuff to get us going and get you going for what will be a great rest of the weekend.
Right through, all the way through till LSU. And there's Johnson going up and getting after it one more time. And, you know, everybody knows the Tim Tebow speech after, talking about Ole Miss, after the loss to Ole Miss. It's etched in stone now down there in Gainesville. But tomorrow on game day, they are going to reveal a Tebow speech from last year's BCS title game that they say is unbelievable.
Well, remember the first half, he was not all that. You know, he gave the speech at halftime, and it certainly affected him because he played lights out the second half. So I want to see that on game day tomorrow. I want to hear that speech.
Here's Kenny keeping it himself. Now throwing to the end zone, and hauling it in is Trey Johnson. He has battled injuries. He was sensational as a freshman, and now Trey Johnson, just another weapon at the disposal of offensive coordinator Herb Hand and the new quarterback, G.J. Kenny.
I got to tell you, though, I'm not crazy about throwing the football.
Yeah, under 2 minutes to go, and you're up by more than two possessions.
It becomes a meaningless stat. I mean, you know, run the football in the game, go home.
Legal forward pass, number four.
Oh, he passed
on the
line.
Offense. 5 yard penalty, second down.
You know, he looked to have made that forward progress and then got rid of it, and they're saying he had passed the line of scrimmage.
I think the officials don't like the idea of throwing the football.
They're on board with you, right?
Well, yeah. And Graham's trying to get the call, and the official's telling him, hey, he was beyond the line. Line of scrimmage is called the 12-yard line there.
Watch that blue line.
Yeah. See where he is. Now, ball looks from this angle to be over. It's not his foot. It's the ball. Where is the ball? And maybe a close judgment
Very
call,
close.
But I think the officials are like, hey, wait a minute. What are you doing? You know, what are you doing? You're up 30-13, a minute to go. Do you need to?
So they wiped that off the board. Now they're going to take a look as referee Claire Gossman will talk things over.
Now, from our angle, it looked like the ball was crossing that blue line. We got another angle, perhaps it doesn't, but that's a close call.
It's going to be interesting to see what Tulsa does in this Conference USA this year with a Houston team that can just light it up.
Yeah, and I think a lot of folks are overlooking Houston. In this conference, it's to talk about East Carolina, it's to talk about Tulsa, and folks are just not saying an awful lot about Houston.
Here's another look. Did he cross?
Ball's in his hand, ball is out, ball's in his hand. That's real close. His foot is on the line, but look at the ball. And again, from this angle, we're a little bit behind.
After further review, the passer was behind the line of scrimmage. The play stands as a touchdown.
Wow.
So the play stands. Down on the field, they said, let's wipe it away. Upstairs, they said, you know what? It's a TD. So Todd Graham watches his sophomore quarterback engineer a late drive here and hook up with Trey Johnson. Third season for Todd Graham at Tulsa. And watching Kenny go in there, boy, it is a system that just keeps on going. Let's look ahead to the 09 season for Tulsa. And we talked about Conference USA and the offenses that they'll be facing. Obviously, the Oklahoma game coming up in a couple weeks. That's a huge challenge. Boise going to Tulsa. So non-conference, extremely competitive and challenging task at hand, Oklahoma and Boise. And then that Houston game on November 7th, Rod. That's going to be a showdown in this conference.
Yeah, that could be for an awful lot in this conference. And Houston, again, a team that really can put points up.
Based on what you saw with the Boise defense last night, a defense that, you know, with Kyle Wilson playing cornerback, man, there's a guy that's going to be playing on Sundays.
Yep.
How do they match up with Tulsa?
I think that Boise State defense is really underrated.
I
think the reputation of the program is all about offense, but we've seen in the last 2 years that defense has come on, and they can win ugly. You know, they can play good defense and win when their offense isn't getting it all done.
Jason. Peyton Jason trying to get to the edge. And here he goes. A nice return out to the 48-yard line. So that gives an opportunity for Kevin Moore to come in and get some time here. He started last year after Kemp went out with a broken collarbone. 12 career starts. He's thrown for 2,600 yards and 10 touchdowns. And here's what you got to like about a guy like Kevin Moore. You talk to the coaches and they say, listen, he has handled the situation of not being the starter better than anyone has. In fact, he goes out and helps Joe Kemp in any way he can.
And that's what you want ideally, because if you have a quarterback controversy, that can divide your team faster than anything.
Trying to set up the screen to Jason, and they do. But he is taken down from behind by Kapo Sarkisian. So the debut of Joe Kemp, 16 of 26, threw a pick, threw a beautiful touchdown pass. Got some stuff going in the second half.
Oh, he's under duress the entire evening.
More with time. Trying to get it to Mitchell. Threw it behind him. Mitchell didn't break to the ball. Kemp, the sophomore, 6'4". It's going to be a learning curve, of course, at this stage.
He learned some things tonight. He's certainly athletic enough, and he's got good enough arm. Gutsy guy, takes some chances out there. They'll get some plays. They'll make some plays this season.
More with time, but he throws it into the ground.
This is the biggest change in Tulsa, their defense. They got a lot of pressure on Kemp tonight. Principally done by James Lockett, number 6, who had a phenomenal night batting balls in the air, making tackles, forcing things. And then you also had Mike Bryan having a big night. But that guy right there, to me, was the defensive player of the game.
James Lockett.
Yeah, James Lockett. He could not be blocked.
Fourth and 6 for Moore. And that is going to be short of the yardage that was needed. Cooper, actually, and we had them last year in the bowl game, but he's been playing and going through camp with a protective boot on his ankle. He is not 100%. Obviously a dynamic running back, but we'll see what he can add to that Miami offense.
Awesome.
Charlie O now getting the call for Tulsa. Charles Opa-Shayton, who was born in Nigeria, and grew up in Allen, Texas.
You did a nice job with that little boxing segment there. You ever thought about doing
it? It's Friday nights, Rod. I was going to suggest
you do that.
Yeah. Years of being ringside.
Seemed like a natural.
Jacob Bauer now in at quarterback. He's the big, strong drop back passer for Tulsa, who was in the mix to potentially land the job that was given to Kinney. Comes from Idaho. It was David Johnson's backup last year when Tulsa led the nation in total offense.
Had an appendectomy over the summer, which hurt his ability to prepare for the season, but he got himself together and got back in the mix.
So G.J. Kinney has the night that he was looking for, and Todd Graham starts the year with a victory. You can see some improvement with Bob Toledo's Tulane team, but Tulsa much too much for them as they were in gear tonight. Our final score, Tulsa 37-13. And for more on this game, you can tune into ESPN News. We'll have a post-game extra coming up next here on ESPN. It's SportsCenter. For more, you can log on to ESPN.com. For Rod Gilmore and on our entire crew, I'm Joe Tessitore. SportsCenter is coming up right now. Enjoy the rest of your night.